Hello and welcome to the 2020 Camp Edward Digital Nature Hike. My name is William Bethel and I'll be your guide on this trail. You can look in any direction and I'll interrupt you as soon as we have a plant to talk about. Thanks for coming along. Talk to you soon. Skunk cabbage, Lysichiton americanus. Skunk cabbage is a very large-leaved plant in our area that only grows in wetlands. For that reason, I won't be grabbing any, because going into a wetland would probably damage the wetland and violate leave-no-trace principles. So, skunk cabbage has a lot of uses traditionally, primarily as a means of wrapping something to eat in it, and you can cook inside that leaf. The other thing to know about skunk cabbage, though, is the reason it has its name is because earlier in the year, it gets very large yellow flowers that smell like, I'm sure you guessed this already, a skunk. Thank you. Our next plant and our first tree is the Western Red Cedar, the Thuja plicata. Now, it's one of the defining trees in our area, and indigenous tribes used it for a number of things, including food, shelter, canoes, and even clothing. Now, if you ever look at the bark of a Western Red Cedar, it has long, stripy bark, and the leaves, as you can see here, look a lot more like scales than they do needles or normal leaves.
That's okay.
This is a sword fern. In Latin, polysticum minutum. Now, on some of these, right here, you'll find these little spores. And the little spores are actually quite useful on mosquito bites, nettle stings. We'll talk about nettle in a minute. And take a look. The reason it's called a sword fern is because of this little hilt right here on each one of the individual leaves. I won't be touching this plant, and neither should you. This is stinging nettle, Urtica dioica, and as the name implies, if you touch it, it will sting you. There are very, very small barbs on all its leaves and its stem that are effectively very tiny hypodermic needles that will get in your skin and cause rashes and swelling. Don't touch this one. Ethereum Felix Femina, or Ethereum Cyclosorum, are both terms for the lady fern. Lady ferns have large diamond-shaped leaves originating from a single point on the ground. Now, like the bracken fern, it can be used to help with mosquito bites. The juices inside the stems can be helpful for that. Additionally, do not eat it when it's raw. It is poisonous, but some people will eat this cooked. Right here, you have the Douglas fir, Pseudosugamensisii, and one of the primary lumber trees in Washington State. You'll notice on this bark here that it has very large grooves, sometimes as deep as 6 inches in the bark, and the bark is even deeper than that. The reason for that is because this bark is actually fire resistant and will protect the tree even in the midst of some of the worst wildfires that we've had. You'll also notice that I'm not showing you any needles or leaves from this tree. The reason for that is because they're almost all 50 to 100 feet above me. The Douglas fir is very good at resisting fires, and one of the ways it does that is by not having its leaves and needles anywhere near where a fire on the ground could spread to them. Our next plant is Salmonberry right here, Rubus spectabilis. Now Salmonberry will have fruits on it that are look kind of like salmon spawn with a lot of little individual drupelets on them. Now the leaves of the Salmonberry are one of the ways you can really easily identify it. See this, and it doesn't look as distinctive, but if you remember to take the top off, the Salmonberry will look like a little butterfly. You can fly it around. This is Snowberry, Symphoricarpus albus, named for its white berries. The albus in the Latin name actually also means white. One really interesting thing about Symphoricarpus albus, Snowberry, is that all of the leaves are different shapes, sizes, and even have different shapes to the edges of them, what we call in botany the margins. leaves behind me are from the plant Devil's Club, and you'll note it is almost entirely covered in thorns. Oplopanops horridus is the scientific name of this plant, and the reason it's covered in thorns is because these leaves are actually some of the most nutritious leaves you'll find in nature. Therefore, it has to defend them with very many thorns. Be careful with these thorns especially, they're very brittle, and they can break off under your skin, and the only way that you'll get them out is when a small blister appears and forces its way out. It can be very bad. But it is also a very cool plant. And if you can actually get hold of some of it that doesn't have needles, can be extremely nutritious. Plant is Indian plum, right here behind me, Omleria sericiformis. In the springtime, Indian plum will have small fruits on it. These are eaten by birds and other small mammals. The leaves of the Indian plum, as you can see here, are fairly smooth along the edges, and on the bottom, you can see fairly strong veining. Leaves do you see here? If you say 7, you'd actually be incorrect. Each one of these is an individual leaflet on what we call a compound leaf, specifically the compound leaf of Sambucus racemosa, the red elderberry. Now, red elderberry will have a lot of little tiny red berries in the middle of the summer usually, and those red berries have been used to make wine. But don't eat them raw because they are slightly poisonous. This right here is Thimbleberry, Rubus parviflorus. Now, you'll notice this has big leaves, rather like the skunk cabbage or the devil's club that we've also talked about, but this leaf is much softer, having fine hairs that won't sting you and won't be painful. For that reason, some people do typically call this nature's toilet paper. So if you forget your toilet paper in the woods, look for some thimbleberry. Some of the identifying features of the leaves are the fact that it has 5 points, the size, and also during the spring and summer, it will have berries about this large that are red and edible. Our next plant is the big leaf maple, Acer macrophyllum. Now, you may, if you're a Latin nerd, catch on that macrophyllum means big leaf, like big leaf maple. Now, you may think yum maple syrup when you think about big leaf maples. Unfortunately, no, that would be the sugar maple, which primarily grows in Canada and northern parts of the central United States. The big leaf maple actually doesn't produce the same variety of syrup, but is still a wonderful part of our ecosystem, having crux in the branches that actual soils build up in, that are studied by soil scientists. the vine maple, Acer circinatum. It's a much smaller plant than the big leaf maple, only being about this tall in general. But you can also see that its leaves have more points on them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, than the big leaf maple does. Thank you all for participating in the 2020 Camp Edward Digital 360-degree nature hike. I'd like to thank Katie Kissinger, Danny Hoppe, and Elise Wright for helping to make this video possible. Have a great day, and we hope to see you at Camp Edward in 2021!